You're listening to the audio production of Genesis 26 through 50 Audio Lectures by Tremper Longman III, published by Zondervan and presented by the author. These audio lectures are a unique learning experience. Unlike a traditional audiobook's direct narration of a book's text, Genesis 26 through 50 includes high-quality live recordings of college-level lectures that cover the important points from each chapter, as well as relevant material from other sources.
Earlier, I commented that Isaac is not a very fully developed character in the book of Genesis. Indeed, he plays a kind of subsidiary role, speaking literarily, in the Abraham narrative and also in his own Toledot, where Jacob and Esau are the primary figures. And Genesis 26, the passage that we're going to look at now, is the only chapter in the Toledot of Isaac that is focused on Isaac and not on his sons. And when we read this text, it's interesting to note that it shares a lot of similarities with Genesis 20, which talked about the time that Abraham went into the Philistine territory for the first time and lied about his wife, Sarah. So a famine hits the promised land again, and God tells Isaac not to go to Egypt, and Isaac obeys God, and rather than going to Egypt, he goes to Gerar, which is a capital city of the Philistines, and meets the king Abimelech. Now, there's some question as to whether this Abimelech is the same Abimelech as we met in Genesis chapter 20. It's more likely that Abimelech, which means my father is king, or my father was king, is a dynastic name. That is a name that's passed down from king to king. We know that's the case with some ancient Near Eastern dynasties. So maybe it's not the same individual. That's not highly important to the point of the story. But as Isaac and his wife Rebecca go to this foreign land, Isaac turns to Rebecca and says, "Tell them you're my sister." And he does so for precisely the same reason that his father Abraham lied about Sarah, and that is to protect himself, so that he wouldn't be killed, so the men of the place could get to his wife. What can we say about this? Well, we could say, like father, like son. In other words, Isaac shares the same self-protective tendencies as his father did. But like with his father, God again intervenes, and so Abimelech notices Isaac and Rebecca being intimate in a private moment, and he realizes that their relationship is not that of a brother and a sister. And so Abimelech confronts him, and then interestingly enough, they enter into a political relationship with each other. So Abimelech allows Isaac to settle in the land, and because God blesses him, Isaac prospers and he grows richer. But the Philistines are envious of him. They plug up the wells and enter into a conflict with him. So Isaac has to move to another region, opens up his father's wells, earlier wells, in this part of the land as well. And again, conflict arises. He has to move a third time, but finally he digs his own wells and no one disturbs him. And he's able to settle peacefully in the land. Now, in this chapter, God also reaffirms his covenant promises to Isaac. He does so even as he's heading down to Gerar at the beginning of the chapter. He says to Isaac, For to you and your descendants I will give all these lands and will confirm the oath I swore to your father Abraham. I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and will give them all these lands, and through your offspring all nations on earth will be blessed because Abraham obeyed me and did everything I required of him, keeping my commands, my decrees, and my instructions. So Isaac stayed in Gerar. And then later in the chapter, he moves back to Beersheba, verse 23, or at least he goes up to Beersheba. And again, that night, the Lord appeared to him and said, I am the God of your father Abraham. Do not be afraid, for I am with you. I will bless you and will increase the number of your descendants for the sake of my servant Abraham. So with these reiterated reaffirmations of the covenant promises, the text makes it very clear that Isaac is the designated carrier of the covenant promises in his generation. And so as the story goes on, the question will be which of his sons will be the one who will carry it into the third generation. But we notice in verse 25 that Isaac built an altar there and called on the name of the Lord. And again, it continues the theme that we saw beginning with Abraham, that everywhere they go, they're going to build an altar so that they designate sacred space where they can encounter God. Because ever since the expulsion from Eden, where all the space, wherever Adam and Eve went, God was there. Now that sin has entered the world, there has to be the creation of a special holy place where you go and meet with God in intimate fellowship. But it's very clear that God is making his presence known to Isaac in this chapter. A very helpful commentator on the book of Genesis, Kent Hughes, helpfully points out how in this particular story, God makes it clear to Isaac that he was present with him in the past. And in verse 28, it says, the Lord has been with you, is with him in the present. And in verse 24, it says, I am with you and will be present with him into the future. I will be with you and bless you, in verse 3. Hughes goes on to say, quote, Isaac's awareness of the dynamic all-presence of God in his life lifted him from cowardice to confidence. Isaac recovered from the disgrace of passing off Rebekah as a sister as he stood tall amidst the hostile Philistines and prospered. And what Hughes is referring to here is the story at the end of the chapter where, Abimelech comes to Isaac, and in verse 27, Isaac says, why have you come to me since you were hostile to me and sent me away? And Abimelech responds by saying, we saw clearly that the Lord was with you, so we said there ought to be a sworn agreement between us and you. Let us make a treaty with you that you will do us no harm, just as we did not harm you, but always treated you well and sent you away peacefully. And now you are blessed by the Lord. And so at the end of the chapter here, Isaac appears to be standing on equal ground with Abimelech, entering into a treaty with them, a treaty that they celebrate by enjoying a banquet together. So the presence of God is bringing confidence to Isaac, who in the earlier part of the chapter was showing great doubt and fear. And, you know, this theme of God being present in Isaac's life reminds us that Jesus, when he died and was raised, promised in Matthew 28, verse 20, to be with us even to the end of the age. And also in John 14 and 17, he talks about when he departs, he'll send the Spirit to be with us. We Christians need to live with the same measure of confidence and trust and courage as we recognize that God is with us, even in the most difficult times of our life. We now come to one of the highlights and most memorable stories in the Toledot of Isaac, the deception of Isaac to steal the blessing. At the beginning of the chapter, chapter 27, Isaac has grown old. He's beginning to think about the future and bestowing his blessing. And of course, according to ancient Near Eastern culture and tradition, he expects to confer that blessing on Esau. And so he tells Esau to go out and hunt. Remember that Esau was a hunter and he was very close to his father. And so Isaac tells him to go out and to hunt and prepare the kind of meal that he loves. Now, Rebecca overhears this conversation, and she knows, remember, that the younger will serve the older. That was the oracle that she heard at the time that she was in labor. And so she knows that it's God's intention that Jacob receive the blessing. We'll come back to the question, though, of whether this justifies her actions here. But she calls her favorite, Jacob, to herself, and she encourages him to deceive the blind Isaac into thinking that he is Esau. Now, how is this done? This is done by putting on a goat skin. So remember, Esau, the name means hairy. He's a very hairy man, apparently extremely hairy. And so Rebecca prepares Isaac's favorite meal, and she takes it into him. And so Jacob speaks to him and pretends he's Esau. Isaac seems a little uncertain at the beginning. He wonders why or how Esau came back so quickly from the hunt. And he says that he sounds like Isaac. So he asks him to come forward. He feels the hairy patch and says, oh, it is Esau. Now, is Isaac so easily deceived? Maybe we might think that he is not really averse to being deceived. But we can't be sure because the text doesn't tell us. Our reticent narrator often doesn't give us motivations of people. But in any case, Isaac is convinced, and so he pronounces a blessing on Jacob. He says in verse 28, may God give you heaven's dew and earth's richness, an abundance of grain and new wine. May nations serve you and peoples bow down to you. Be Lord over your brothers, and may the sons of your mother bow down to you. May those who curse you be cursed, and those who bless you be blessed. And so Jacob receives the blessing from his father. And at that moment, or soon after Jacob leaves the room, Esau arrives with the meal, and Isaac says, but you were just here. And Esau says, no. And then he pretty quickly realizes that Jacob must have deceived his father into bestowing his blessing on the younger son. And Esau is beside himself. First of all, he weeps and he grows angry toward Jacob. And he says to his father, bless me too, but Isaac can't do that. Rather, he...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.